Hello, everyone. I'm Jim Garrison, and I want to welcome you to day 139 of Humanity Rising. Humanity Rising is an initiative of Ubiquity University and now over 350 organizations from around the world that have come together in the midst of this extraordinary pandemic to provide a daily opportunity for people from all over the world to come together and share experiences and solutions and confer in terms of how we can increase our strategic effectiveness. As world events have unfolded, a pandemic that we thought, you know, in the spring would be over potentially by summer has regained its footing and dug in with enhanced virulence in countries around the world, all over Europe. Countries are engaging in what they're calling circuit breaker lockdown, trying to do something in the month of November so that by, you know, the middle of December, people can come out and begin to enjoy their holidays in a normal way. It's not clear that that's going to happen. In the United States, for example, all 50 states have COVID cases on the rise. And in the last several days, 17 states have set records for the number of new cases and deaths. And in the last 24 hours, the United States set a US and a world record of 138,000 new cases in the last 24 hours. It's an extraordinary situation, not only globally, but in the United States in particular, which is seeing rising cases. And now in almost all 50 states, the ICU units, the intensive care units, are full, and the number of cases are increasing. So one of the major countries in the world is facing a critical situation with regards to the pandemic. And at the same time, while the President of the United States does essentially nothing to ameliorate the situation, as you know and we've reported, he's embraced the doctrine unique in the world of what they call herd immunity, where you literally don't do anything and you let the pandemic just run its course in the hope that it's gonna go away at some point, or there may be a vaccination down the road. And projections are now that the US deaths, which are now running at 1,000 people a day, will reach over 400,000 by the inauguration on January 20th. Amazing situation. At the same time, it needs to be reported that while the election was announced on Saturday, as we gather together on the following Wednesday, Donald Trump has not only not conceded, but has directed the General Accounting Office, which oversees all transition, to the new president to not have anything to do with the Biden transition team. There's been a shakeup in the Department of Defense, where the Secretary of Defense and three other senior personnel were fired and Trump loyalists were appointed. The Secretary of State today, Mike Pompeo, said that everything was in order for a transition to the next Trump administration. The Department of Justice has fallen into line and is now calling for systemic investigations. And all this is happening when courts across the country are throwing out the suits being filed by the Trump campaign, because there's essentially been no fraud. And in fact, the lieutenant governor of Texas today offered $1 million reward for anybody that could show fraud. And I want to just note that, because with all the attacks that have been leveled on the longest continuous democracy in the world, in the midst of the pandemic, more Americans voted in a fair election than almost at any time in US history. So what this means is that the people in our election stations, the people managing the votes, the people counting the votes in 50 states across the American mainland and heartland, held firm against an unprecedented attack on democracy by the President of the United States. That's how weird this is, folks. That's how weird this is. The world is in an extraordinary situation. And it is our delight and our honor every day at Humanity Rising to bring you these updates, generate conversations that matter, and seek to transform them into actions that can make a difference, like we'll be discussing today. While all that has happened, cities around the world are going virtual and applying technologies that are taking municipal life to the next level of sophistication and effectiveness and coherence. So as Whitehead says, and I've quoted before, the fairies dance and Christ is crucified. It's the best of times. It's the worst of times. It's the greatest of times to be alive at this extraordinary moment, when literally the fate of the human sojourn on this planet is being determined. And it's going to take all of us working together in spite every odd and obstacle, just like we saw protecting American democracy, for humanity to rise and save ourselves from ourselves in order to secure the legacy for our children. So thank you everyone for joining. I will now like to hand it over to Sabine von Gafka, my good friend and distinguished colleague from the great nation of Sweden, who will commence our program. Sabine?
Thank you, Jim, and thank you also for giving us such a eloquent update, as well as what is happening in the world, and also the intention of Humanity Rising to really be that platform where all of you are welcome to both share your perspectives, open your heart and mind, and to really discuss all of the essentials when it is concerning creating the future that we're heading towards. And like Jim mentioned, today's session is about smart cities, so the new frontier of smart cities that entails both engagement of citizens, social structure, and of course technology. And really one could say that the rise of smart city enables community engagement, digital transformation, smart mobility, urban infrastructure, and so forth. And it's really using digital technology to connect, protect, and also enhance the lives of its citizens. And whether that's through IoT sensors, video cameras, social media, and so forth, but providing that nervous system so that citizens can and city operators can get constant feedback to really improve the cities, but also make informed decisions and provide, of course, connectivity, mobility, and safety services. And in this panel, we have a profound selection of experts, a really global global representation from all over the world who will be sharing their insights and their expertise from the different sectors that are sort of connected within the sphere of smart cities. And that is, of course, artificial intelligence, VR, blockchain, AR, and so forth, and smart infrastructures. So they will be diving deep into what it entails with smart cities and also how that will navigate the path for citizens' well-being as well. But before we start the session, as we always do, we take a 1 minute heart coherence. And I also wanted to mention, probably many of you may know or may not, but today is 11/11, the 11th of November, the 11th month of the year. And it's a portal of shifting foundations for new creation of a new epoch. So this is really, today is, you know, an opening of a really, really intense portal that we're really is said to catalyze us from the old epoch to the new epoch. And we can already feel that transition in our outer existence and world already. And 11/11 represents the energy of the foundational pillars of creation. And it's that sacred union or the portal or the gateway for the new perception or dimension of reality. And it's said that this specific 11/11 gateway comes in a wave of, like I mentioned, shifting foundations in the decade of 2020. And it said that the very foundational pillars of an old epoch will give way to new ideas, new perceptions, beliefs, expectations, boundaries, knowledge, and more. A bit like humanity rising, what we're providing, especially we're just providing the platform. All of our knowledgeable speakers and all of our chat people and all of you engaging are the ones who are really our contributing catalysts of change. And it's also said that this gateway 11/11 opens on the last day of Venus, at a shamanic gate of the heart chakra. So that's why I wanted to mention that. So let's keep that in mind. It said it's a once in a year opportunity to align with the energy of abundance, spiritual connection, and deep personal awakening. So let's have that at heart when we take some inhales and exhales for a 1 minute heart coherence. Join into that 1 minute heart coherence. And for those of you who might be new to Humanity Rising, we do this heart coherence, just 1 minute of inhale and exhale to really just align or arrive in the now, to open our hearts and our minds for different perspectives and to really engage in the here and now. So it can be done when you open meetings, it can be done like this, more with a mantra or music in the background, but it really is a really profound way to just becoming present and to open up for what is to come. So our convener for today's panel on smart cities is Dr. Katerina Zalamova. She's a recognized smart cities expert with a special interest in zero waste infrastructure and the circular economy, along with the adaptation of digital infrastructure focused on economic development and social change. So Katerina, I hand over the word to you and your panelists.
Thank you very much, Sabina. Thank you very much. I hope you are hearing me well. And it's incredible day today, incredible honor to me to share our new perspectives for this new epoch that it's coming. I just read a horoscope a few weeks ago that was saying that the planets, how they order, it was repeated in 1518 when the Protestant church was built, was promoted, and it was a huge change in the epoch. And now we again are in this new situation. We have been living in technology for the last 20 years. Nowadays, the technology smoothly enter in our life in a way that nobody can discuss it, can judge it. Of course, it's true that also we'll have philosophical discussions around how much we need to be connected to the technology, but it's already a fact that we are connected some part of our life. Maybe people that are living in the nature, they don't connect every day, but in one moment in their life, they connect. They need to connect because this is everywhere in our life and it's very smoothly already integrated in our way of thinking, way of doing. And to me, technology, when I start 6 years ago in the smart city field, because I found it as an interesting, neutral way to speak about different topics in our society, in our humanity, that was initially on a fighting cage, always in a contrary. And it was very hard to see how they find a peace between them and synchronize and bring a new possibilities, a new future. So I find that technology, it's difficult to put it in some political speeches or social or ethical discrimination topics. You know, we have all this in our society for many, many years. But when the technology comes, it was difficult to put it somewhere in this on black or white side. So it stayed neutral and it persists neutral for the last 100 years as the peak of the atomic physics in the beginning of the century started. It was really huge development. And in the last 20 years, we just take it easily, all the results. It's become easy for everybody that you don't need to know, you don't need to be intelligent to use the technology. So for cities, to me, it's happened that it's an opportunity to make our life easy in a way that because of the technology, we can robotize more of the labor work. What I mean, we can have robots to do our food, to clean our streets, our houses. And the robots only need energy and energy in the sun. You know, and today we have the photovoltaics, we have the wind, we can generate energy cheaply. So we can free our lives from heavy jobs and we can dedicate this energy in creation, in arts, and thinking for a better future. So I was very, very inspired of these possibilities. And then I really engaged inside. And today we're here. I am bringing with me as experts in different technologies. We will make small exhibition of one artificial intelligence case about optimization of traffic. Then we'll have a case about how the 3D environment is used nowadays for virtual events to bring virtual business expositions. Now we have a conference, but today there is a platform that you can have the exposition of the enterprise and see their products. And then we'll have one presentation about blockchain that it's nowadays one of the hype words, the buzzwords. And to me, this technology is very interesting to make really available, the real smart city in our life. Because it's not about money, it's about data. The blockchain, later I will present a new concept of the mix of this free basic to me technology for the next 10 to 20 years. This will be the tendency. We are presenting how this can go to virtualizing the cities and what is the meaning of virtual city. And then we'll discuss with Paul, he's coming from the real estate market, how this, if we virtualize our cities, if this will slow down the buildings and all this physical world, or will continue, how this is disrupting the traditional industries. So before to continue, let's give the word to my panelists. I am opening with Jason, this technology show that we have prepared for you. Please, Jason, the stage is yours.
Thank you, Katerina. Hi, everyone. As my name is Jason Baik. I'm from Korea. I'm very happy for introducing for our solution for enhancement for smart city solution. We focus on the artificial intelligence to transportation industry. So I want to show a short presentation for easy understanding. So I want to share my screen there. Wait a minute. Okay. So our vision is to remove traffic congestion and traffic accident using AI technology. In this smart city area, is very important to problem of the transportation. Frankly, it's a traffic is a every day happen to a congestion or accident. All of this is a very waste time or waste money. So we want solve this problem using by AI. So finally, we can get using artificial AI technology, and then we can get the future traffic condition from 3 seconds to 6 hours ahead. I mean, when you drive your car, you can catch the future traffic situations before arrive some specific situation, like some risk, or like some congestion, even some cases accident. We can avoid that using its AI. So finally, we found solutions in the automaker area. So next slide show how to using our future contents. That is usually head-up display screen. This screen is like some common display information, but our head-up display different contents. That is the future upcoming traffic situations. That is also using AI. Next slide is also is using AI in the camera, but this is different. This is not monitoring real time. That is the real predict future traffic accident. So these solutions can avoid the traffic accident using AI. Finally, we can control traffic light system using AI. These solutions is controlled by the future traffic amount. This is helpful. Maybe these solutions, you can need not wait in the crossroad. Maybe they have no car or no foot worker will be changed in the traffic light signal. So this solution is already efficient from the 10% more high speed in the, by the car. Okay, so I want to solve traffic problem using AI. So this solution is will be contributed by the big smart city project. Okay, thank you for listening to my presentations. I will keep the next panelist. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Jason. So how you can see here in this case, AI, it's artificial intelligence, it's a software that can understand how we, the people, are moving around and can help us and advise us about risk situations on the street. And this is why there is so many people engaged to build these solutions for many different systems to understand and help us to know, to predict a little bit, a few seconds in the future what will happen. This is totally human nature that we want to know a little bit about the future. So this is why there is a important group globally that it's working solutions that will say the future tomorrow, no? And now we are moving to the 3D environments. That is something you'll say later that to me, it's coming as an interface that we'll have with the technology. It's something that my children, it's engaging a lot and enjoying a lot. So 3D environment, maybe it's not for our age, but it will be definitely for the age of our kids that are coming in 10 years, not too much. So Débora, the stage is yours.
Hello, Katerina. Thank you. Thank you for inviting me to be part of this session. I will share a short presentation with you as well. Just a second. Okay, here we go. Are you seeing right? I am from ARTEK. We are a studio originally founded in Buenos Aires, Argentina. Now I'm based in Barcelona because we are expanding the company here, no? And most of our work is about trade exhibitions around the world. No? We design solutions B2B, it's a design solution for companies and trade shows for marketing. And with this new panorama, with the pandemic, something that already was the natural way. I mean, each day we are using more technology and more virtual resources to work. And it's very good and important for the expansion of the companies. What these circumstances did was to boost this need, and we developed a whole platform for keep doing trade exhibitions, business meetings, and sales in a virtual environment. So this is very important because it helps the business and the companies to connect to more, the cities to connect as well, and the people, as we also do at the face-to-face events, for example, no? So we designed it. This is about how cities can be connected. And for example, a trade show, which is very important here in Barcelona, the Mobile Expo, how could we connect the companies or the people that this year were not able to come because the show was canceled, no, for postponed for next year. How can we connect with people from São Paulo, from other world parts of the world to keep moving their business on? We developed this platform, which is called EV. It's like a nickname for interactive virtual spaces in Spanish, which is our native language. And what we work on is to bring to the companies and to people 3D environments that deliver very good user experiences. So it's not only about being connected, but also bring to people a great experience that will make business to be better. No, will be, even if it or the contact in a congress, or if you're exhibiting a booth in an event, if you're talking about developing a whole virtual city or some part of a city when you can have stores, you can have smart learning. So that can be used for many purposes as well as we are used to do in the real world. And when all this about the COVID ends, people will be meeting again, will be joining again, trade shows will be going back to the personal, you know, the physical way. But the virtual resources will stay as a very powerful tool for business. So not all the business meeting will need to be presential. I mean, that can facilitate logistics, can facilitate the reach that a company can have today in a physical way, virtually, that they can go further, no? Some of the benefits that this environment brings. And the visibility, it's also very environmentally sustainable, because it decreases a bit the volume of traffic and of trips that involves having a business meeting, for example, or even a show. Also, the live shows or the live markets can be combined with the virtual resources. Now you can, for example, have a trade show happening in Hong Kong, and during the trade exhibition, and after, we can have the digital twin of this trade show, where the companies after, when the trade show ends, the people can still be connecting and doing business, improving their economy and their companies. No, one special point in here for us is that the design as a main point combined with the connectivity, because the truth of all this is that the main point is people. So who are connecting are people. We are talking about companies, but companies are made by people and also business. So if the experience is good, even being virtual, if the environment is well designed and the experience brings an impact to people, that will be good for people, good for life, and good for business as well. So I leave here our information, and we can connect later to see more if you want. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Débora. Here in the chat, I put some videos from Débora. To who is interested in this moment, Dream Tank, it's a foundation, NGO, that it's trying to help children dreams to become true. And they just launched a project about virtual campfires to connect children with elders, and that they can keep there also in the virtual world this storytelling tradition and connection with the future. It's very interesting project. I hope we get more news in the next few months. I just this week have the news that they are starting to develop the images and to showcase later with videos how this will go. So we are expecting in spring that we can visit these campfires and participate with the children there. Later I was explaining further why we think that the 3D virtual interface is coming to be the next step in the next 10 to 20 years. It's coming to be this 2D that we are so used to. It's changing because it's more engaged, and you have the feeling that you are moving there, you're participating. And already the children are quite used with different video games that are in 3D. And then lastly, for this technological exposition that we have prepared for you, I want to invite Ronny to present us and educate a little bit us about the blockchain and how what is our vision, why this is one of the important technologies for cities and for transformation of our society. Ronny, can you put your camera? Okay, so here you are. The stage is yours.
Thank you. Let me just see if I can, I can see myself now. Thank you. Thank you for this invite, and it is really a great pleasure to be here and to share with you a little of my experiences that I've had in the past 6 years exploring the blockchain in general. And from knowing nothing about blockchain until a point now where I'm actually in a lovely situation where I can start thinking of how can we use blockchain as a part of improving life for everybody and actually making life worth living, thinking that you have something to look forward to. This part of digitizing everything and creating a digital platform as a foundation for a future virtual reality and even a city or city digital platform, it is great to be part of that. Anyway, I would like to just jump in and share the screen of a few slides that I've made. Let me just see if I can actually work this out without not so used to this. So let me see if it works. Yes. And let's just start off by introducing my or this blockchain that I've been building and thinking of towards this future reality. And the blockchain is called VP Ledger, Veritas Persona Ledger. Verified true person is every single identity on this ecosystem. It is a new blockchain technology really for building P2P communication. This is like an infrastructure with a minimum data storage. In this sense, it really aims to bring sustainability in this data economy market and then minimizing the demand of physical infrastructure. This minimizing the physical infrastructure is a vital part for us all to help reduce the impact of CO2 in this world. I'm coming from having a team of 50 people around the around Europe to helping me work out blockchain solutions for other companies, and their focus right now is actually developing for other companies. What I've been spending time about in the past couple of years is trying to envision a solution using blockchain where we can have a real impact on human life. And this is where we are right now. If we go back a little and say, what is blockchain? I mean, some of you out there might actually be sitting and saying, what is blockchain? And I've tried to think of how to really sum it down to something that everybody could feel comfortable about. And, taking it really down, you might just say there are, when you speak about Lego, for instance, you are building brick by brick. And to me, each brick really has its own story. And when we're speaking blockchain in general, this story is a bunch of data all put into this brick. And when you build on top of it, this brick is sealed. And although you can actually see what's going on inside, you can never access that brick again. So it is in this way an immutable, product. And you are basically using this kind of brick to store your data, to never be removed, and then build upon it. This is from where this distributed ledger come from. It is really data in this sense, not controlled by any single identity, but with this technology that we are now moving towards, it allows you to actually create real life on the blockchain. And the blockchain that we've created is where we invite every single user to enter and create one account per user in a protective democracy and governance. And the access point is with an identity verification, really for everyone to have full access to this platform. You might consider it a little bit similar to the inner market we have in the EU, where all transportation, all activity throughout the community or all these countries is actually happening across across countries, across borders, without having to show IDs or documentations whatsoever when you bring stuff from one place to another. It's a bit similar here, but you actually initially show an ID, show your proof of identity, and from then on, you may actually be able to cross countries, cross borders, and start communicating together. This is where we have integrated this functional payment system as a part of it. We call it a wallet. So here, and the next one, just for you to have an idea of the data storage part of all of this, we have a theoretical case where we have a touristic mobile application used in New York City. And in 2018, there was like 65.2 million tourists, generating around 9.6 zettabytes. It amounts to an energy consumption for data storage of something like 597 megawatt hours. That's a negative environmental impact of 3.5 million tons of CO2. It's a conversion, so this is basically the amount, you could say, of impact for one city of tourists in 1 year. When you take it into use of VP Ledger, we could then basically go in and say that the VP Ledger blockchain P2P communication infrastructure, based on using blockchain, is actually aiming to reduce that data consumption by up to 100 times. And it allows us, to go in and look at all these different points when we're speaking a digital platform. We have the interactive city, the circular city, innovation hub, smart city, public services, visitors, residents, and all of that. All of these people, all of these identities are basically presented in one level on this digital platform, on this blockchain. So every single identity, whether it is a human being or a drone for that matter, they all have an identity on the blockchain. They are a user per se. And each of them have an active part in our future life when we are interconnecting. And instead of actually going in and accessing from so many different points of entry, we are now able, on the base of the blockchain, we are able to access everything in one place. So just to sum it up, the blockchain impact here, what we're seeing is that each user is based on this, on the VP Ledger blockchain, each user is in control of their own data, which will allow eventually a new personal economy to emerge, because you can now, as the only one with access to your data, your private data, you're the one who's able to start actually offering it even to other people, whether it's against money or basically just sharing with your family or whichever. You have also this part where if there's no high demand for physical infrastructure, then you have a much less environmental negative impact. And here you also have your account profile as your identity. It's one digital identity valid for all basic access. So one identity takes you everywhere inside here, provided, of course, everybody agrees that this is the level of identification. Now, there's no more need really to enter these same data multiple places. So you're reducing the data consumption. Finally, you have what I would call a great part of it. You have an improved security by actually entering via the blockchain out to all these applications. So you have suddenly no more phishing incidents, hacking, or similar when you access this via VP Ledger blockchain. So this is just basically my introduction. It's very short. Normally I have to take 4 hours to introduce you to this. I've done it, well, I was supposed to take 3 minutes, a little bit more, but you are really welcome to, join me in also trying out the VP Ledger. It is in its early stage where you can actually create an account and start using the wallet, by asking me, for instance, for some test coins or whatever of the Vimples on this blockchain, you are welcome to access via this QR code, the creating account for free, and then connect me on either my email or via any of these social medias. Well, this is, let me just, how do I get back again to my own? Now I'm completely lost here again. So if you can still see me.
Yes, now you are up. Okay. Thank you very much, Ronny. And I see that we raise a lot of interest in the chat. And I will try to summarize this technological exhibition, why we choose these free technologies to show you. And to answer some of the questions in the chat with my resume, these free technologies, when they're integrated, so we create a project for their integration that is called Virtual City. And, okay, sorry, I cannot see myself, but maybe you are there. So the idea is that if you use the blockchain to enable the users to be identified and communicate between them, it is the old idea to the people that was in the old internet. We have the torrent and the peer-to-peer communication that my computer is connecting to your computer and we're exchanging the files between us two without anybody around. Then the cloud comes, and the cloud is something very abstract. It is that now we are exchanging our files between you and me, but not only. It's passing through another platform, another physical infrastructure that it's called server. And normally this can be Amazon, this can be Google, this can be Alibaba around the world. There is many enterprise offering these servers. It's a physical infrastructure. So now our communication is going through another intermediate party. And this means that the data is multiplied. But of course, there is some benefits to this. So this is why the cloud comes around. And now what is, then the blockchain was invented, that it's decided to make the communications again distributed. With the cloud, we centralize through these servers, through these third parties the communications, and then they are distributed. So what the blockchain is doing is that now again, we are coming back to the old fashioned one-to-one communication. And this makes that you can keep your data locally in your control. And you just need to open your door to your virtual house and invite people and share with them. And this is where a new business, personal business models can be addressed. So you don't need to give free access to your house. You can decide to charge for this data. And you are in total right. I mean, it's the same as your house. You can invite friends or you can make a party with tickets. And here, to be optimal, that we don't have too many resources later for computational resources, and again, physical infrastructure for it, we use the artificial intelligence. This name is quite a buzzword. But what is under this name, it's a lot of different ways of data analytics. We take that, and our brain, it's a machine for data analytics. So nowadays, this software is trying to understand how we are analyzing the data as humans and digitalize it for the machines. This is why it's called artificial intelligence, because it's for the machines. But basically, in this field, the research is going from the neurology and the bias, the human bias that we have, understanding these human biases, they're creating software. They're totally copying how we are thinking the humans and using this for data analytics, plus everything that we have in science as a scientific approach to understanding what we have in our environment. So the blockchain, it's a technology that connects different people or different pieces. It can be software, it can be physical pieces as devices and sensors, and it can be people in a distributed way. So everybody is somewhere. And we put this this together, so it's quite close how our human brain is working. And what we know as humans is that our world around us, it's 3D. So this is why we believe that we need to integrate as interface to this, the 3D vision in the devices, when we interact with the devices. And why is this? Because in images, we compress a lot of data. So it's more easy if you have an avatar and enter in the environment and all the data that the machines are taking from our physical world, it's bringing to their virtual world in the internet. And then you don't need to have this data in layers to read it. You just see it with your eyes because your brain is already adapted to this environment. This way children are very used to play in these 3D games. And my children in this moment, they're very engaged to build businesses, farms, and infra, robots and manufacturing. So together here, these people are my friends. We have sometimes virtual coffees in this moment because of COVID, that we discuss what can be the future and how we can make it better. So we end up with the idea that maybe we can combine this free technology to create a platform for the cities that you as a citizen can enter, can recognize your city, can put your house inside. So remotely you can operate your house by your avatar. You enter and leave the same in the virtual world. And then when we have events, we can experience it in the same close to the physical experience by seeing us with our avatars. And this is very interesting when you think about surveillance. Today, we are really, how to say, it's not nice that somebody is looking at you with a camera. So we are proposing to cities to use the avatars as identity that they can identify the citizens and with specific case. Again, because it's this, in this type of identification, again, it's you in, under control because it's your profile, it's your avatar. So you can control in any place where the surveillance is coming. So you can request why is it, what is the issue exactly. And here I'm inviting Paul to speak with us and explain us how is his experience in China where they have smart cities that are totally connected. They have the surveillance everywhere accepted. And how people there it's feeling about this surveillance and why they're so open to share their personal data. Paul, can you join me in this conversation?
I can, thank you. Thank you, Katerina. I think it's been a really good conversation so far. And I think it's really important to remember that technology has really started to shake up the real estate industry just over the last couple of years, speeding up decision making and delivering more meaningful engagement in terms of how we use our cities. And it's fast becoming a disruptive force in residential sales, commercial lettings. And we're sort of leaving people now saying, what next? And really importantly, for our context of our conversation today, what impact will COVID-19 pandemic have in terms of speed of change? And as you just mentioned then, Katerina, the adoption of technologies in the context of both the virtual city and the reality or real city, which we all live in. The development of smart cities across the world has enabled us to create virtual mirror cities, virtual buildings, interactive exhibition spaces, as Débora Bessa was explaining earlier. And Katerina, we've been working with the panelists here, looking to explore new ways of how we can do business, how communities can exist, trade, and collaborate in a virtual city. So moving beyond sort of simple graphics that show the art of the possible, and introducing artificial intelligence and data analytics into our virtual cities mean that these virtual cities can now engage directly with us in the real environment. And as you said, the application of technology in China, and those of you who follow media will have seen probably in the last sort of 48 hours, China have just released a new satellite, a 6G technology satellite, which shows the speed at which China and Asian countries are adopting technology and adopting technology in a way which helps their cities function. And Katerina, this is an area that you're looking to explore, isn't it? About how we can combine the virtual and the physical. Do you want to sort of respond to our panel, yes, to the others?
Before to go to the virtual, because here we start with the data, I was saying that maybe you can share with the audience your experience in China when you were there and see how these people with, they didn't have problems with the surveillance cameras and be recognized on the streets because they found a value for them and they really acknowledge it. So can you share with the audience how you perceive this value that the people it's seeing? I mean, there is a sacrifice, but in their case, the benefit seems to be higher than sacrificing some privacy.
Yeah, and I think that's really important. And again, taking this back to sort of the COVID conversation, the ability of technology to understand where people are and how people are engaging and how people are using spaces, environments, means that people have been willing to hand over technology or hand over their data in exchange for access to services, access to be able to move around. So I think one of the developing things that we're seeing is more and more the technology that's in your hand is engaging with the technology around you. And to do that, you need to have engagement with cameras, with other sort of technology. And we're seeing sort of a real expansion in China and other areas of bio technologies. So technologies which we're all now used to in terms of fingerprint recognition, retina recognition, but increasingly now facial recognition. So one of the things for those of you who haven't visited China or be visiting China in the near future, once the current pandemic is over, facial scanning recognition is now the norm. And that facial recognition will give you access to buildings. It also monitors where you are, but it also can be used to understand where areas are becoming, they're too busy, or how transport systems need to adapt and change. A lot of the systems that exist in terms of metro systems, et cetera, are all unmanned and therefore need to understand with a level of AI how the services are being used. And I think that's an area where we're going to see more sort of adoption of those ideas and that technology. But I think, you know, one of the areas of caution, and this has been sort of raised both in terms of the chats, but also in terms of our conversations ourselves, Katerina, is, you know, how willing are the population or the people to give over access in exchange for ability to use the environment in which we live and work.
So if I can summarize your words, about our vision here as a group, what we are coming to present to the audience is that to the moment, all this need for data and and also personal data was to teach the machines, to integrate the machines in our lives. If you think about them like a babies, when you have a child, you need to feed it with data. You need to be with the child all the time. Starting from you, who you are, you're feeding your personal data. I'm the mother, my name is this, I take care of you. Until the last person that he starting or her is starting to meet on the streets, on the schools and stuff. So the machines are something similar. And this is why the companies that are trying to develop these intelligence machines, they're so much for our personal data, because the most important piece in the ecosystem that these machines will find are humans. But if we understand that there is a two-end collaboration, that we can take a value from the machines, then it's happening that sacrificing some of our privacy to teach the machines to serve us there are some benefits that can be interesting to be discussed. The problem that I see up to now was that it wasn't done in a collaborative way to engage massively with us, the users. I mean, the companies that have been developing the solution, they were so focused in the fight who will be the best in the market. So they forget that in the end, we need to use it and to engage. So in our solution here, we try to totally to disrupt this idea of centralizing and keeping the market. We don't believe that it can be done by one company to educate all the machines and have this artificial brain that there is many movies, scare movies about one brain controlling everything. We don't believe in this. And this is why we are mixing the data analytics with the distributed blockchain technologies that make everything locally and doing by purpose. What I mean? If you need data, you need this data because of some reason. So you need this data in the place that you have the need. So you take it just there locally, you use it for your purpose, and it's end. There is no need to keep this data for a century. And then we believe that if we implement the infrastructure like this, it's enough flexible because it's virtual to help us to imagine a totally imaginable world inside. So we are focused to replicate the existing cities in the physical layer and the physical world. But because it's virtual, it's open for everybody to imagine another situation. So we also want to see in the development of our infrastructure that people engage to build virtual cities that are not existing in our world and simulate different organizations, different political organizations, if you want. So this can later create leverage what we can see faster in a few weeks or in months on a simulator than building it in a physical world. And if there is some negative issues, we cannot solve it so fast. So just to summarize what the technology is bringing to us, and from one side, it's benefit. From the other side, it's making us a little bit stressful. It's speed. What in the past we needed to do in years, today, because of technology in the virtual world, we can make it in hours. It's so fast. For many people, this change, it's very stressful. But already and now, because of COVID, I totally believe that people start to embrace that our reality is no more stable. We are living in a continuous change, and the norm is just change. So I think we are going to this new era to just imagine ourselves doing different stuff. We don't need to stick to one profession, to one personal situation, or to one place. We can live through the virtual world. For example, we can have a remote working place in a forest if we have connectivity and work everywhere in the world now. So this is where I am going back to you, Paul, about these virtual co-living spaces as COVID nowadays closed many people at home and many people suffer of no vision and perspective what should be their jobs. So what do you think? You know that real estate, they already have these 3D designs of beautiful buildings and offices. Do you think they will be happy to open them virtually for this as a virtual jobs so we can recuperate the economy?
I think one of the things that's really come out of the current crisis is, you know, the sort of leveling of borders and the leveling of countries. We proved it today with this conference that's taking place. People from around the world sharing ideas, things that we would have previously had to get on planes and come together to do. And it's actually this collaboration that's really key. And I think what we're learning is how do we take that collaboration and create a virtual environment in which people can work and live. We may be in our homes more than we were back at the beginning of the year, but we still crave the interaction with other human beings. And can we create a virtual environment which enables us to fulfill some of our basic human needs of interaction, collaboration, growth, support, sharing, all the key things that are really important to us. And I think one of the things that we're taking into the real estate, if you design and build a building, it can take 4 years plus to get that physical building up and running and getting people in it. So the question that we've been asking, Katerina, is whether you could start bringing people into a virtual office space, start to have people working together. Can you offer centralized services to small startup businesses that provide within that virtual environment data management, data analytics, things like the human resources aspects that a small business might not be able to have on their own? Would that be an advantage? So we're not saying move away completely from the physical, because I think as we move out of the current crisis, that return to the physical will happen. But what we're seeing, even in exhibitions, etc., well, why don't we have coexistence of physical and virtual? And if that enables us to be more flexible, work from home, have more time with our families, but still be in a virtual business environment when we need to be, collaborate with others in a virtual environment, I think that's going to be really important. You mentioned earlier there's the camp side for young people. I'd like to see more engagement with young people and all generations with business, rather than just people within the key age groups of business. And I think this will really provide us this platform for global collaboration, the big community. I think that's something, isn't it?
I just will take on your words about the future of work and why we're so excited about this platform that can be a 3D platform with avatars. And I mean, the idea is that, okay, today we can work remotely in these virtual offices with our avatars and experiencing like a video game, our jobs, that it's making more enjoyable from one side. But our idea for the future is that tomorrow you can educate your avatar because it can be fit with your data and it can start to represent it really there. So in the end of the day, if you spend enough time with your avatar as a child and educated professionally in your profession, maybe in the end of the day, your avatar can work your job and you can just spend the money. So this is my vision. This is why I'm so excited. And I don't know if we replicate exactly our problems in the virtual world because of the experience, it's different. There is many things I see already in kids that they cannot translate from the physical world to the virtual, for example, discrimination. They easily start to engage and speak with square heads and ugly avatars there, and they really don't care about this. And I don't know if it's because of the environment, but I can see in kids that are engaged with these games that they're open for languages. They don't care what is the language that they need to communicate, and they don't care about who is in front of them in a sense of gender or race or color. And to me, this is really important for the future because they are the generation that really will bring this technology to their maximum use. So to me, it's a hope there that we can solve without entering directly in conversations these issues, just because of the experience. It can bring a smooth change in our behavior in general. And of course, there is a negative impact. And I believe it's up to us. I mean, it's about participation. I haven't seen to the moment a possibility for us as a citizens to really participate in the technological development. We haven't been unable because we have been treated as a passive users. In our vision here, as you will be just a door there with your personal data and you will open or not yourself for this world, you are participating. And what Ronny presents here was very important. We choose his technology between many different blockchains. Just a little bit about the blockchain itself. It's a technology that it's digitalizing the collective relationships, the collective, if you say, intelligence. And to me, it's important technology, not so much about us as humans, but about robots, because it's digitalizing our understanding about trust. So in robots, when a robot machine starts to communicate, you need to have a software that it's representing what we understand like trust. And this is what it's really the blockchain as technology. So the idea here is that thanks to the blockchain in the VP ledger, all the users are actively participating. So the decisions that you need to validate or certificate, it's based on a democratic model. In their consensus is a type of software that decides which transactions should be available and which should not be. And nowadays we have three main technology, that it's Bitcoin, and that it's Corda, it's of the big banks in Wall Street, and then it's the VP Ledger, as three different ways to digitalize the collective intelligence. The Bitcoin is based, their consensus, how they take the decisions and validate the transactions is based on anarchy. Everybody participate. It is called public infrastructure, that it's open, that everybody enter, and everybody is doing what they want. But in the end of the day, because of the experience that we have with Bitcoin, we found, as this is normal in our life, that anarchy doesn't exist. Always there is some groups that take the power over the mass. And this is what is happening nowadays with Bitcoin. Corda is a centralized, protective, distributed technology. So they have a government, however it's 5, 10, or 20 nodes. It's technology, it's nodes. Maybe these nodes are property of one company, maybe it's 10 companies, it's not important, but only this 10, 20 limited number of nodes can take the decisions. So this is more authoritarian structure as we have in our social structures. And Ronny, it's digitalizing the democracy. So as much you're contributing to the global well-being of the network, you are promoted to get to higher levels of decision-making, and your node as a software can validate different levels of transactions. So this way we choose them to be our backbone for the virtual city, because we really believe that democracy is the social structure that we need to represent for the technology itself and build it. And this is totally open. I mean, here we really can engage for citizen participation as users directly for the technology. So I don't know, Jim, how we are on time. Maybe we can make 30 seconds for everybody to say their last.
Yes, I suggest we just have a final statement of a minute or so from everyone, and then we can wrap it up.
Yes, Ronny, please, starting with you.
Yes. Yeah. Well, I mean, I think actually I managed to say as much as I wanted to do there before. But I think it was, I see when the based on the questions that are mentioned on the side here, and I've been trying to answer some of them, but of course there's quite a lot, so it's impossible almost to cover really all of them. But I think it's important to understand that. Blockchain is a technology, and you know, everybody is coming out with different ways of thinking that their blockchain is going to change the world, and so do I, of course. But in the same time, you also have to accept that every single blockchain technology out there, they may actually have a purpose. So if you are building something, you need to build something where you accept that you cannot do things alone. Just the same way as everybody in the world needs to come together and work together in order to achieve something. It's really the same things with when it comes to blockchain technology. There are so many different aspects of what's out there that this whole part where you connect blockchains is a very important part of it, and I'm of course, this is part of what we've also been building in our technology, is that we built the technology on the base of being able to connect with other technologies inside blockchain to facilitate and optimize the end user experience for all of us. So, and that's when it comes down to it. Of course, and another thing was actually this part where one said about energy consumption. Yes, BTC is known for being this product that goes out and actually uses as much energy as Switzerland as a country. I heard that the other time. And of course, that's another part. You go in and you find out what is it that you don't want to be used in a blockchain. And that's why, for instance, in the case of VP Ledger, there are many other ones also, like VP Ledger, who is not mining their existence. They are actually using these nodes that Katerina has mentioned before. They use those in order to set the pillars for the infrastructure, and you have servers generally provided by people or companies that allows this to work on. So that's where we are at the moment. I wish to thank you to all of you, thank you for listening.
Débora, your final remarks.
Yes, basically what I think is that the technology, I was commenting this in the chat with some of the audience, that the technology is a tool, is a very powerful tool. We are very thankful to be using it to expand our world, no? Because now we can connect all around in the companies as well, as our clients do when they do business this way. And one word that you said, very important, is to integrate to our lives, to not replace our lives, but to integrate the technology to our lives. And smart cities will only be really smart if we focus on people for all the activities, not only the business, also the entertainment, and, you know, so that's it. And many thanks to invite me to join this golden group. It was very nice.
So Paul, maybe for your final remarks, you can explain your personal excitement about the future, how you see it from a personal perspective, because I know that you are really engaged with smart cities and technology, and you have this flame of excitement. What is coming on?
Yeah, so I think that the really exciting thing here is about how we use technology as a tool, which everyone has been saying, but how we use it to augment reality, to make our lives better, to make the world in which we live, we work, everything better. And I honestly believe that is where we are heading with this technology. Technology, virtual reality, and coming together so that buildings and the spaces in which we are in are working for us to make sure we have the best environment, the best air quality, the best light quality. And I really start to think that that will change how buildings and how we use buildings. The fact that we have all been trapped in our homes for the last 8 months makes us realize how important the environment in which we live and work is. And I think really the adoption of technologies to help us understand where we go forward is going to be really, really interesting, and technologies will enable us to do that. I think the one area, and it has been picked up, we need to ensure that we bring everybody along with us, and this will only work if we have all the people involved and a global community. So this is about equity of access to the virtual world and how we bring that into the augmented world. I think that's really important, and that's probably our biggest challenge. How do we ensure that we don't create a golden diamond city for people who can afford it to live in virtually, and everybody else out in the real world? It has to come together. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Paul. I just want, as a final, to respond to one question from the chat, that it's how one user, one person can build wealth with these technologies. And to me, this is what it's inspiring me, that you can make money easily without a lot of effort because you have a value, because you are creating data, you are a data machine. So this through the platforms can become a revenue source for you. So we can totally erase poverty with this. Secondly, because blockchain is a tracking technology, we can track and educate ourselves for this a positive environment impact. And today there is a financial market for this. So we again have another source for us on a personal level to recognize and use it, not just for the big corporates. And lastly, for the future of work, I really want to have my avatar to work for me. And I spend more time on the beach, on the mountains, recovering nature, and doing really stuff in the physical world. I really believe that thanks to the technology, we can spend more time in the physical world with real experiences than so much virtual experience. But of course, there is a transition time. So there will be some years that we will need to invest our time in the virtual that later can work for us. So thank you very much. Thank you, Jim, for the opportunity to share our ideas and visions for the next epoch. And the stage is yours. I'm coming back to you.
Thank you, Katerina and Paul, Ronny, Débora. This has been splendid. You've lifted my spirits. I was starting to feel, as you probably heard from the introduction, a little down about what's going on in the United States. So just to hear from all of you, the extraordinary amount of creativity that cities around the world are demonstrating, particularly with this use of blockchain. I mean, Ronnie, you gave a beautifully lucid description of blockchain. It's one of these terms that everybody thinks they understand, but nobody can quite explain. And you did it admirably. So I want to thank you. And Débora, you know, the way you were talking about how cities can become alive through digital technology. You know, and if you just think about it, I mean, this may be the miracle of our day. You know, here the pandemic shuts the world down, puts us in isolation, in lockdown, social distancing, and we're more intimate and interconnected now through just Zoom than maybe humanity's ever been in its history. So, you know, every crisis is an opportunity, and all the challenges that we have, you know, and Paul, the way you, your insights into how things can develop in such a robust way, you know, just given a little bit of common sense and political will, you know, and this is what was so exciting about Amsterdam in May. You know, the city of Amsterdam demonstrated political will by embracing donut economics. You know, and I wouldn't be surprised if blockchain isn't part of what they're going to do, and all kinds of live digital interactivity isn't embedded in how you put human well-being at the center of human development at the city level. So I really want to thank you. We've put, by the way, Katerina, we've introduced her to Marilyn Hamilton, who's the founder of Integral Cities. We're going to be doing a whole 1 week program starting 2021. So we're going to take a break between December 11th and January 11th for the holidays. And then on January 11th, we're going to convened Humanity Rising 2021 with Marilyn and her colleagues, and hopefully Katerina, and maybe the three of you, on cities rising. Because the city level of development may be the most exciting nexus where the future is breaking ruthlessly through us to create a better world. So I just want to thank you, Katerina, for bringing this panel together, and I hope we see you again with Marilyn and Beth and others in the new year. And we want to keep tracking these kinds of development. Because in the end, humanity rising is about solutions. You know, I talk about the pandemic and Trump and various world issues as they appear in the news, but that's just the foil. It's just the backdrop. It's the stage for the real action. And that is people of goodwill all over coming together in their respective ways, as you guys have done today, and demonstrating that humanity's on the move. The future is being implemented. And we can take pride, I would say, in being part of this momentous movement of spirit and ideas and technologies and political action to ensure the continuity of human life on this earth at a moment when the scientists are telling us we're running out of time. And I just wanted to end with, you know, this observation that's been made by a number that, you know, the world is getting better and better, like we've seen today in virtual cities, worse and worse, like it is in the United States with Donald Trump and climate change and all these issues, faster and faster. Yeah. We're in a race of tipping points.
Jim, just shortly to say that in transition times, always are both that is seeming worse and seeming better together. It's a really paradoxic feeling that in one side it seems that it's the worst cannot happen more, and in the same time it's happening something so amazing. But this is the beauty in the transition, you know. People Absolutely. That are living in one age or another stage, they cannot see it, no? And fortunately for us, we can experience this experiences that it's not quantum. We are not jumping from one stage to the other. We can really feel these transitions. And it's really amazing experience. I'm so grateful to be in this epoch, in this process, because my life was transition all my life. Our generation have been seeing so much in a political, in a industrial and now technological level. So thank you very much again, and Beautiful. Hope that audience really engaged and enjoy it. See you soon.
Now we'll bring this call to a close. Everybody's welcome to join the chat, the after session chat that we have each day, particularly any of you panelists. The link is right there in the chat box. And then tomorrow, everyone, we're going to have a very exciting session on sonic coherence. One of the things we've emphasized from the beginning, as it's getting better and better, worse and worse, faster and faster, everything's in transition. We're all being caught up in dynamic change. We have to stay coherent. And that's one reason why we do the heart coherence meditation when we start every day. And one of the themes for humanity rising are technologies that we've seen today for the cities. They're also technologies for how we keep our own internal equilibrium. How do we keep coherent with one another, with ourselves? And there's a lot that we can do with sound. So tomorrow, there's going to be a whole session on sonic coherence on humanity rising, starting at 5:00 p.m. Central European time. So once again, Katerina, Paul, Ronnie, Débora, I thank you. Brilliant. You inspired us all. Bye, everyone. We'll see you again tomorrow.